for all of those who didn't show up tonight, they get to watch us now on YouTube later. It's wonderful to be here with everyone this evening. This has become a little bit of a special tradition over the last few years, where we've done a little rabbinic team round robin. This year we did it before the High Holidays, and now we're doing it before the Pesach as well. And it's an opportunity to get the juices flowing. I know there's so many years where I show up to my Pesach Seder and I sit down and I think to myself, uh-oh, I have not spent nearly enough time thinking about what's about to happen over the next few hours. And so the idea of doing this evening is just for each of you, for each of us on this call, to spend a few minutes reflecting on our Pesach Seder, thinking about some of our favorite sections, beginning to allow our minds to wander and wonder about what the Pesach Seder can be. And we're going to do that through a few interactive polls and through the rabbinic team sharing some of our own highlights or insights or foresights about the Pesach Seder. So wonderful to be here with everyone tonight, and feel extra gratitude towards my co-hosts, Rav Steven, Rav Asara, and Ravani Bracha. We're just really proud and excited to share Torah and share the space with everyone this evening. We're so grateful to all be able to be together on Zoom. I see so many of our Zoom regulars, those who hold down the fort in our Zoom programming, and also lots of folks who typically show up in person, or sometimes maybe are reading the daily emails. Just wonderful to have such a nice mix of people this evening. So with that in mind, we're gonna get right to it and begin with round one. What is your favorite non-Magid section of the Seder? And as part of this, we are going to ask, we're gonna give a poll for everyone to answer as well. Just answer number one, section number one. Did it show up for everybody yet? Yeah, great, just answer section number one. Your favorite non-Magid section of the Seder. And we'll play a little music in the meantime while people think about it.
Aim a dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for two zoos in. Had-gad-ya. Then came a stick that beat the dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for three wheels in. Had-gad-ya. Then came the fire that burnt the stick that bit the dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for two zoos in. Then came the water that quenched the fire that burnt the stick that bit the dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for two zoos in. Then came the ox that drank the water that quenched the fire that burnt the stick that beat the dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for two zoos in. Then came the butcher that slaughtered the ox that drank the water that quenched the fire that burnt the stick that beat the dog that bit the cat that ate the kid that father bought for three wheels in. Then came the angel of death.
Death.
That slayed the butcher. That slaughtered the ox, that drank the water, that quenched the fire, that burnt the stick, that beat the dog, that bit the cat, that ate the kid, that father, but for two zoos in.
I won't spoil the end of that song just yet. So I think we can leave the poll up for anyone who didn't get a chance to answer and wants to answer throughout the duration of the evening. But first, we'll turn it over to Rev Steven to answer. What is your favorite non-Magid section of the Seder?
So wonderful to be with everyone, and Erev Tov. It's great to anticipate the Seder coming up. And I'm going to cheat a little bit. My favorite non-Magid portion of the Seder is the second cup, which some might say marks the end of Magid. And for me, I especially think about this moment at our open Seder, which we host at the Bayit, I hope we'll have well over 100 people together on the first night. And when we come to that moment, I breathe a sigh of relief because the servitude that I experience on the Seder night is a little bit of servitude to the clock. We really got to get to dinner by around 9:30 p.m. So when we come to the second cup, we've gone from servitude to freedom, knowing we've completed the Magid, hopefully with togetherness and energy and excitement, participation from so many friends from a broad swath of the Bayit community that reaches so far and welcomes so many on the Seder night. And in that bracha, I'll share my screen to offer one insight. The bracha comes from a debate in the Mishnah, the 10th chapter of Tractate Pesachim, which you see on the right side here. Rabbi Tarfon has a very short version of the bracha, Asher ga'alanu v'ga'alat avoteinu mimitzrayim. Blessed is God who redeemed us and redeemed our ancestors from Egypt. Rabbi Akiva has a much more expansive one. He seems to suggest that he agrees with Rabbi Tarfon and says, but let's add on some more. We're not just talking about the past. We're asking for something in the future. So may God, the God of our ancestors, bring us to future celebrations. May we greet them with peace, happy in the building up of your city, and joyous, God, in your service, and eat there from the special offerings. Blessed is God who redeems Israel. And of course, as is the custom in many cases where we have liturgical debates, the sages say, why do we have to choose? Let's do both. And so the bracha that we have as the Birkat HaGeulah, the blessing over the second cup, incorporates both. But what you see here on the left is the actual language of the text in our Haggadah. But if you see, there are a couple of phrases that are added in from the version in the Mishnah that combines both to what we actually say in our Haggadah. So we heard, blessed are you, God, sovereign of the universe, who redeemed us and redeemed our ancestors from Egypt. And then jumping over one line, so may you, God, bring us to future celebrations to rejoice in your rebuilt city. But there's this extra little part that Rabbi Tarfon didn't mention, and Rabbi Akiva didn't mention, that makes its way into our bracha. We thank God who has redeemed us in the past. And before we get to the prayer that God redeems us in the future, we talk about the present. V'higiyanu halayla hazeh le'chol bo matzah u'maror. Didn't just redeem us in the past, and we're not just focused on the future, but right here, right now, we thank you, God, for bringing us to this moment. And one last little thought about the idea that the Seder, which is so much about the past and so much about the future, don't forget about the gift, literally, of the present. What is the gift of the present? Having arrived at this day to do what? Eat matzah and maror. Is that so much to celebrate? I mean, there's a lot of wonderful things we eat over the course of the Seder night. Are matzah and maror really the delicious highlights? I think in some way, actually, this is an opportunity to say, yes, the present is a gift, but yes, there are also bitter and hard parts about the present. And even still, we say, thank you, God, for bringing us to this day, even to swallow some bitter pills that we might be dealing with in this moment, even for wrestling with challenges. It's a sort of a different kind of shachianu. Shachianu, v'kiyamanu, v'higiyanu, and brought us to this night to wrestle with whatever we're wrestling with, to take in the bitterness and the sweetness. May we all experience all those things this Pesach.
Hey, everybody. This is so much fun. Brought up so many memories looking through the Haggadah. It's not a specific one of the 15 steps, but a specific part of one of the 15 steps in Nirtza, which is the song. So I could have gone directly to the songs, but actually what popped up for me is something that I've always loved, and that is, Ubchein Bayehi Bachatzi Halayla. This is a poem which seems to me goes through so much of our history. And the first one is Bayehi Bachatzi Halayla, the same way that Am Yisrael were redeemed in the middle of the night, right at midnight. So this poem goes through a lot of our history and finds so many other things that happened in the middle of the night. Now, why do I love it so much? First of all, my whole family, we love puzzles. And this felt like, always felt to me like a riddle and a puzzle, because you have to look for the clues if you don't have an English translation or if you don't have the answers down below, which I never had growing up. So I always tried to figure out and pick out the clues. Wait a minute, which person is this talking about that this happened in the middle of the night? So for instance, the first one, there's Ger Tzedek Nitzachta Kenechalak Lo Laila. So that is a little bit of a hint to Abraham. And then in the second verse, it's Yisrael Yasar Lael. Yisrael is when Yaakov became Yisrael. Yasarla, when he prevailed, that was over the Ish, the Malach, when he had that fight with him. Remember that happened in the middle of the night when he crossed over to get whatever it was he forgot there. And continuing on, each one of these had a little clue. So there were a few parts to it that I loved and I still love. First of all, that was towards the end of the Seder. And I don't know how it happened, but I would end up on my father's lap. And for some reason, other people were cleaning up. But because I was sitting on his lap and saying it with him, I was allowed to not clean up at that point. And the second thing was, I tried to keep up with him saying these hard words. I was a little girl. I couldn't do it. So it was so much fun for me to do that. And as time went on, I learned each time. And every year, I still do it. I still try to pick out the pieces without cheating and looking at the bottom to see if I can figure out that little clue. And it continues on the second night. By the way, in Israel, you say both of them the same night because there's only one Seder night. So the second one is Uchen v'amartem zevach Pesach. And this is all about things having to do with Pesach. Remember when Abraham served the angels, ugot matzot, cakes of matzah? So Abraham was celebrating Pesach somehow then and continuing on all through many parts of our history. I still love it. And then at the very end of the first one of the Vayhi B'Chatzi HaLaila, I'm going to sing you a song that I really love. Karev, karev, karev yom, asher hu lo yom, asher hu lo yom ve'lo laila. Karev, karev, karev yom, asher hu lo yom, asher hu lo yom ve'lo laila. Ram, ram, hoda, ki lecha yom, אף לך הלילה, ניי, 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 רם, רם, הודה, כי לך היום, אף לך הלילה. I seem to recall that the Basna Rebbe wrote this tune. That's it, moving on.
Hi, everybody. Almost Chag Sameach. It's so lovely to see so many faces. I happened to see the results so far of the poll. So I have in I'm pretty sure that one of the most popular pre-Maggid moments is Yachatz. And that's what I wanted to talk about. The moment that we, near the beginning, where we lift up the matzahs and we take out the middle one and we break the matzah. So I'm going to tell you why I like it, but one of the many reasons is we have the honor of doing Seder with my family in Boca in Florida, where I have been almost every single year. Very grateful for the bayit that I've been able to continue our family tradition of being together here with my family. And for, I don't know, as long as I could remember, my dad always hides the afikomen on the first night. Of course, when we break that matzah from Yachatz, one half becomes the afikomen and the other half is used for motzi matzah a little bit later. And, you know, for many, many years, I could never like really see how and when he hid the afikomen. It was like literally magic. It was there 1 minute and just gone. And it wasn't until like, really, just maybe a few years ago, and I began to realize what the trick was. And so that was always a special part of our Seder. Now, on the first night, my dad still hides it, and on the second night, the kids hide it. That's how we do it here. But why do I like Yachatz? So Seder means order, and much of the Seder is all about ordering chaos. There are four cups and there's sections and there's a table of contents and it's supposed to be a very highly ritualized meal together. And of course, if your Seder is anything like our Seder, it's anything but ordered. There's always a lot of chaos by the time we get the kids to the table, there's a lot of throwing frogs at my dad, and my mother throws marshmallows at the kids when they answer questions. It's very chaotic, actually. And I think that Yachatz actually is the moment, is one of the first moments in the Seder where chaos enters. You see, it doesn't actually make sense that we break the matzah all the way at the beginning. We should remove the matzah right before motzi matzah, much later in the Seder, right before we eat. That's when it makes sense to do anything having to do with the matzah. So why, near the beginning of the Seder, even before Maggid, do we remove the matzah and break it in half? I have to tell you, Rambam and actually many others asked the same question. And in fact, Rambam did do yachatz, did break the matzah right before motzi matzah. And so this is actually a question that many, many have considered. So there are a few answers, but the answer that I want to focus on is how I started, which is that there has to be some disorder that is introduced to the order right away. And I think that the message there is that, yes, of course we strive for an ordered world. Of course we strive to control all the pieces of our world and our life. But actually the reality is that so much of our world, so much of our lives is filled with disorder, is filled with things we cannot control, is filled with brokenness, is filled with chaos. And I think that the message of Yachatz is that we're supposed to remember that even though we might be striving for order, even though we're striving for order, the reality is that there's chaos in our lives, and we have to figure out how to hold and embrace and handle both at the same time. And so we do yachatz right at the beginning, disorder within order.
I wanted to share, it almost feels not fair to share this, but my favorite part at the Seder is one of the paragraphs in benching. And what feels strange about that is because we bench all the time. And so it's almost ironic that in this evening when we have so much liturgy and so many bonus songs and tefillot and prayers, that the one that I feel so drawn to and connected to is in benching itself. And the reason this is that in our family, we would basically sing from the beginning of benching through the end of the Seder, straight, without stopping, without any talking, from right after we ate the Afikoman. And so if we ate the Afikoman around like 12:30, we would sing from 12:30 to 2:30 as a family. And sort of one of the places where this really, sort of the singing really set in, we would start with benching out loud, Baruch Atah Hashem. But then where it really set in was in this one section, which I'll share with you. Can everyone see this? Great. So we have the section of Bamarum Yilamedu Alehem V'Alinu. And so it's just a paragraph from benching that I usually fly through. Right? Bamarum Yilamedu Alehem V'Alinu Zechut Shetehe L'Mishmeret Shalom. On high, they should show for them and for us merit that should be a preservation of peace. They sounds like refers to the Avot, to our ancestors. They should make sure that we are okay here. Venisa bracha me'et Hashem utzdaka me'lohei yishenu, and we should carry blessings from God and charity from the God of our salvation. V'nimzachin v'seichal tov b'nei Elohim v'adam. We should find favor and real appreciation in the eyes of Hashem and humankind. And we sang it to a 1990s Miami Boys Choir tune that goes like this. Bamarom yelamedu aleihem v'aleinu zechut shetei limishmeret shalom v'nisa bracha me'et Hashem u'tzedakah Melohei Sheheinu Vinim Zachen Visechel Tov Bine Elohim Viadam Vinim Zachen Visechel Tov Bnei Elohim, the Adam, sort of has a good, you know, Jewish choir Broadway vibe, and this is what our family sung. And I think there's something so special about the Seder that can take something so normal, so typical, something that we say every day, and elevate it to such soaring heights, to filled with meaning and connection and memory. This is true about benching. This is true about even the mitzvah to recall that we were taken out of Egypt, which is a mitzvah, something that we recite every single day in the Shema. And yet on the Seder, we do it special. So that's my sharing for this evening. And with that, I think we're up to round two. So I see that on the poll, I didn't know how to make it two separate polls. So everyone kind of already answered the second one. So why don't we do between rounds here, we're going to check out the solution to the polls or the results. So if you didn't have a chance to answer, this is your moment. We got 51% participation. And I'm going to press end, and we're going to look through some of the results before we jump to round two. All right. Thanks to the more than half of you who participated. Ooh, one last one. Just jumped right in. Perfect. Okay. So I'm going to share the results. And everyone should be able to see on their screen now the favorite non-Maggid section of the Seder. I'm sorry, I know there are 12, or, you know, there's more than 10 sections of the Seder, but you're limited to 10 answers in the polls through Zoom. So we had to combine some. So I know Hallel and Yirtzeh might be very separate for some, but I had to make some decisions to put them together. So he sees that Yachatz got two, which is nice. Korach had one. Shulchan Aruch, 6 out of 16, 38% of the votes. It's always such a highlight. And Hallel Nirtzah got the most with 7 out of 16. I think that clearly such a special part and such a memorable part of the Seder. It's so interesting when we think about when we prepare the Seder, like the things that we can share with one another are so often from the first half of the Seder, because it's where there's so much content and so much conversation. But Hallel and Yirtzeh are the parts that happens in people's homes that most of us never even get to know what other people do for Hallel and Yirtzeh. And it's like special and unique to individuals and to their families and to their own customs that they create. And then round two, we're gonna get to see everybody's answers before we hear from the rabbinic team. And so it looks like the highest is a tie between the four sons and Dayenu, which I think is wonderful. The four sons and Dayenu are the tie for the top. And then Vehicle Sha'amda, I think that's supposed to say Vehi Sha'amda, that must have been auto-corrected by the Zoom poll. Vehi Sha'amda or Ami Oved Avi, sort of the meat of the Seder, some of the main parts. And then a few for Halach Ma'anya and Avadim Ayinu and the plagues and Rabbi Gamliel. So wonderful to have the participation. I think the four sons in Dayenu, they're like some of the earliest parts of the Seder that we learn, and they really stick with us until today. All right, I'm going to stop sharing. We're going to pull up just the screen and give round two. What is your favorite part of Magid? And leading us off will be...
You said me.
Okay. Rabbi Sarah, perfect.
I was helping you out there. Okay, first of all, we obviously call it the four children and not the four sons. And it's a favorite because there's a lot of kids around and everybody takes a part and we read it dramatically, and there is so many fun things to say about these four children. The thing that is sort of glaring at me this year. You know, we read this every single year, and it's fascinating to me how every year, yes, I have four sons, but I don't know which one is the wicked one. You'll have to let me know after, Stephen. Every year, it's just insane that something new pops into my head. So when I was looking this year, I was noticing that some translations refer to each child as the wise child, the wicked child, the simple child, the child who doesn't know how to ask. And it could be a description of their personality types, or it could just be like a pseudonym for them. You know, like, have you ever been in a house and been known for a certain characteristic trait? Like, oh, Sarah, she's the sweet one. Or, oh, you know, my sister's name is Erica. Oh, Erica, she's the smart one. And our parents maybe have a tendency to name our children, their children, in this way. And then we're sort of stuck with that characteristics trait, whether we're actually sweet or smart or not. We're stuck with having to live up to that title. And sometimes that there's a lot of pressure to do that. And it also means that people aren't looking at us in a multifaceted way. If we're stuck with being always the wise child or the wicked child, it doesn't leave room for us to evolve or change. We're stuck in one personality trait. And of course, many mefarshim, I'm thinking about the Solanter Rabbi Yisrael Solanter specifically, who says that each of these children contains all aspects of all four children, which means that it's possible that each of us have aspects of being wise and wicked and sometimes don't know what to say and sometimes just feel, you know, dumb or simple, whatever that means. And I like the idea that we don't have to be pigeonholed, so to speak, into one personality trait, and that actually the goal is to show all of our sides. And I think that I hope that as a mother, I try not to peg my four children in a certain way so that I can let them evolve. And I hope that others see me in a multifaceted, multidimensional way. And I'm not only seeing it through the eyes and through the lens of one thing or one way, but there are multifaceted identities revealing many aspects of my personality throughout my life.
Thanks, Rabbi Sarah. I get to go next. So I think one of my favorite sections in Magid is Vihisha Amda. It's such a powerful moment. We stand, we lift the glasses, and we sing. In our family, we have the Vihisha Amda. And then we've recently, or in the last number of years, have also adopted singing Yonatan Rezel, the Yaakov Shweki Yonatan Rezel tune of V'hisha amda lavoteinu, such a beautiful tune. And I want to say something important, but by first sharing something challenging, which was one of my worst V'hisha amda experiences. And this was when I was 18 years old. I had the privilege of taking a trip to Poland with my yeshiva, and we were in Auschwitz, and there was another group of young Israeli high schoolers in Auschwitz, and they walked through the camp with an Israeli flag, singing, you know, almost joyfully, "V'akadosh Baruch Hu matzilenu mi'adam," and God saved us from their hands. And I remember sitting there feeling so kind of horrified and such discordance between saying these words and God saved us from their hands in a place where over a million Jews were murdered and not saved from their hands, from our enemies' hands. And that experience has really sat with me for a very long time. You know, it's an image and a sound that I can't really removed from my mind. It's been burned in. And this question of Vihisha Amda marks the sense that we're still here, which might be something that feels gleeful or joyful, but it also carries with it the recognition that so many of us aren't here, that there are so many more who could have been sitting here at our Seder. There's so many more Jewish people who've been murdered over the ages and who weren't saved from the hands of our enemies. I don't really have any like great solutions for this problem, for this theological issue of, you know, why are we saved, or why was our family spared and others not? It's a type of survivor's guilt or theodicy question. But I think the power of Vihisha Amda for me becomes heightened when it's situated in the recognition that even as we've had so many enemies who've tried to defeat us, and nonetheless, we are still here today carrying on the religion, it's sitting alongside of the depth of pain and suffering and loss that all of our families sit with, whether it's of immediate relatives or distant relatives who we never even had the chance to know, or just the recognition that this is such a deep part of our history and our Masorah. And I think Vihisha Amda captures that sense of the loss, real, even as it's a moment of celebration, it captures that sense of the loss of generations and generations throughout Jewish history.
The passage I want to share from Magid is one that speaks to me about the Seder experience and sort of marks what the Seder experience is in our Jewish identities. You know, in Magid, we sort of move quickly from step to step in the early stages. Avadim Hayinu, and we have the story of the five sages, and we have the four children, and it stays, you know, quick and moves from thing to thing. And then we come to the Midrash. And that is ostensibly the real moment of retelling the story. And that's when people sort of start to like flip ahead in their Haggadah. Okay, wait, how many more pages is this part? And like a little bit of eyes glazing over, and what is this Midrash attempting to explain? And we kind of hit that moment with the very first of the Midrashic interpretations, as I'll share my screen. After the, what is this Arami Oved Avi? We have the very first phrase, Vayered Mitzrayma, he went down to Egypt, Anus al pi hadibur, translated here, helpless on account of the word. And there's an interpretation here in brackets, the word in which God told Abraham that Abraham's descendants would have to go into exile. In other words, here, the interpretation is the word is Brit Ben Abitarim, that covenant in which God foretold our servitude in Egypt. That is the word which compelled Yaakov two generations later to go down to Mitzrayim. Others say it much more locally. Vayered Mitzrayma, Yaakov went down to Egypt, Anus al pi hadibur, compelled by God's word. In the moment when God says to him, don't be afraid to go down to Egypt. You only have to tell someone not to be afraid if you know they're afraid. And so this is God telling Yaakov, you got to go. And it's going to work out in the end, maybe in the long term end, but it's going to work out. And that was God pushing Yaakov down to Egypt. Maybe in another sense, Yaakov was also compelled by God's word, maybe less literally, the unfolding story which took Yosef down to Egypt. And really what drove Yaakov to Egypt was to reunite with his son. But he was a victim of his circumstances. He wouldn't have gone if he didn't have to go to join up with his family. And in this moment, as we sort of sit down and whatever our feelings about the structure of the Seder night, and in this sort of midrashic moment, we're like all anus al pi hadibur, where something is a choice in arriving in the Seder night and delving into the liturgy and the traditions. And there's some way also in which we're compelled. There are circumstances beyond our control that we don't even always totally tap into that have driven us to this moment and compelled us into this tradition and this practice. And it evokes the feelings that we talk about when we reflect about the giving of the Torah, that the Jewish people in some way, that the mountain was held over our heads. We didn't choose it. We were compelled. But of course, we also chose it. And it's that this is the moment in the Seder night where we sort of sit down and say, yeah, this is all just happening to us. We're characters in a much bigger play. And also I choose to be here with all the complexity of it. I want to share one little tiny additional teaching that Ones makes me think about, maybe a little bit comical, but also for me profound. It's the teaching about studying Torah in the bathroom. We're told that you're not allowed to learn Torah in the bathroom. The Gemara in Zvachim quotes a halacha which was taught by one of the sages in the bathroom. And the Gemara says, wait a minute. You're allowed to contemplate matters of Torah everywhere except the bathhouse and the bathroom. The Gemara answers, La'onso shane. It was different in this case because Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Shimon was so compelled by Torah that there was no place where it wasn't in his mind. It was with him everywhere. And so I just offer the bracha that as we settle into the Seder night and dive into that midrash, we appreciate that we are part of something so much bigger than us, and there are circumstances beyond our control that compel us to be here. And also we choose it, and may we dive in such a way that we sort of compel ourselves and own that compulsion in a way that takes over our lives in a beautiful way.
I'm going back to one of the passages that Rev Stephen just said we pass over quickly. I've always loved this passage, and then at one point I started loving it even more. This is the passage that begins, just a minute. It begins with a story, Ma'aseh b'Rabbi Eliezer, b'Rabbi Yoshua, b'Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah, b'Rabbi Akiva, b'Rabbi Tarfon. It's a story of five sages who gathered together and were reclining. And as we know, Mesubin, reclining happens on Seder night. Where were they? They were in Bnei Brak. They were having a Seder. I always loved this idea that the Seder went back so many years. And I imagined, putting aside the question of where their wives were for the moment, but maybe they stayed the rest of the night because they were talking. There are many interpretations for this, but I loved this imagery of the five sages sitting around a table and talking and expounding and talking more all night long. This idea that a seder could have gone back so many, many, many years to when they lived. But first I want to share a little piece of Israeli trivia. I think I've shared it before. They were in a place called Bnei Brak, but it turns out it wasn't exactly where Bnei Brak is today. It's right near Bnei Brak. And if anybody here knows Israel, there's a junction called Tzomet Mesubin, which is very near Bnei Brak. I never knew why it was called that. It is called that because that is where these five sages were. So even the name of that junction, Tzomet Mesubin, which is near Tel HaShomer, it's called Tzomet Tel HaShomer as well. It's called that because those five sages from our Haggadah were there, which I just love that it goes back so far and even is in our modern day. But then when I gave a class on Agadita, on stories in the Gemara, I learned something about the next passage. Amar Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah, that's one of the five. Hare ani kiven 70 shana. It's as if I am 70 years old, and then it continues, it's a whole halachic midrash halacha, explaining why we have to say Kriyat Shema in the morning, at night, or not. But I, as a child, I was told this story that I was like 70 years, kiven 70 shana. Why? Because for some reason, this rabbi, his hair had turned white overnight, and because he became as if he was an older man, then that's why it's kiven 70 shana. But when I gave this class on Agadita, on stories from the Gemara, then I really learned inside what happened. And this is a story in Barachot. I'm not going to go through the whole story, but it is a story of the deposing of Rabban Gamliel. I've learned it and taught it from so many different directions, the limits of rabbinic authority, having a seat at the table, showing respect. There are so many different ways, and there are so many different heroes that I have in this story. It really is, if not my absolute favorite Gemara story, it's definitely up there. And the reason that Rabbi Elazar ben Azariah looked like he was 70 years old is because he was only 18, and they were afraid that if he was the Nasi, the president who was deposed, he was an older man who had a lot of gravitas. But who's going to listen to an 18-year-old who's trying to teach people and be the head of the high court? And therefore, God made a miracle and allowed him, gave him 18 rows of silver hair. So every year when I read this, it actually taps into so much more, into this very rich story, and reminds me that many parts of the Seder are like that. And for me, the beauty of it is that it brings along so much more of our history. It's not just the psukim from the Torah. It's not just the songs, but there's so much more that's enfolded within it. And I think the Baal Haggadah, the person who wrote the Haggadah, or the Baalei Haggadah, those who comprise it or put it together, they were very wise in some of the things that they picked and really spark your mind to think in different directions.
One, two, three, four.
All right, everyone, we're up to the lightning round. And so the way this works is that this part is unprepared, unscripted. This will be, the music is exciting, I know. This will be the lightning round. The way it works is that each member of the rabbinic team will suggest a word, and the other three members of the rabbinic team have to give a 30-second reflection on that word, maybe hopefully connecting in some way to Pesach. Everything will, please God, be Pesach-themed, unless there's a great surprise. And just to offer short reflections, feel free in this moment when the word is said aloud to also offer your own reflections in the chat, either a memory or a story or a text that the word sparks for you. And I believe the way we set it up is that I get to give the first word. Just kidding. Rabbinic Bracha shares the first word. So feel free to unmute yourself. Let us know. We'll listen to some music while we have a chance to think about it. And then we'll go to the very end of the rabbinic team.
The password is numbers.
The association I have with numbers is, I get to go first. So the association I have with numbers is the like endless count of how many people are going to be at the Seder in the days leading up to the Seder. And it's one of those things where even if you write the list down, every time you count the list, it comes out different. Sometimes it's 11, sometimes it's 13, sometimes it's 12. And then like cousin Seth drops out and Aunt Judy jumps in. And all of a sudden now we're at 15 and no one can understand how that happened. I think it gets captured in one of these children's books about, do they have enough chairs at the Seder? But I love kind of the, to reference Rev Stevens' beautiful Shabbat HaGadol Drasha. And if you didn't get a chance to tune in, you can see the redo on YouTube as well. The sense of like the jockeying and the creating of the chabura, of the mix of for the Seder that occurs in the days leading up. And then you set out all the chairs and you try to figure out where everyone's going to sit. And then you say, do we have too many chairs? Or you don't, do we not have enough chairs? And there's almost this sense that we don't even know until the Seder night begins what the final number is or what the final count is at the Seder. And that's true whether it's with friends or with family or even a small group. I find that, that dancing around the numbers is such an exciting part of the Seder preparation. You know, lots of Aunt Judy's in the world. Thank God.
Numbers, 4, 10, 50, 200, 250. It's always a math quiz and a math equation. And one thing that we do in our Seder in order to try to get everybody involved is when we get to different sections, we ask different people to share a memory. And so when we get to that section after the dipping of the wine, the write down the plagues, when we're talking about the how it's not really Rabbi Akiva says 250, and before that it was 250. We go around and share a math memory, some memory or association that you had with math, and everybody has a math story. For example, I am very proud to share that I won the math prize in 10th grade in my high school. Thank you very much.
When I heard numbers, I went to some various numbers spots in the Seder, who knows one, the various versions of the, the plagues in the Midrashic, as Rabbi Sarah referenced, 210 years of slavery, 400 years. But then for fun, I went to the book of Numbers, Bamidbar, and I started trying to remember, is the book of Bamidbar quoted anywhere in the Haggadah? And I don't know the answer, but that's my homework for after tonight. But it made me think about the fact that, of course, when we exit Egypt, we head into the wilderness, Bamidbar, the book of Numbers called Bamidbar. And the beautiful idea that as much as the exodus from Egypt was this incredible act of liberation and loving kindness from God, of course, the prophet says, that God remembers the loving kindness of our youth as an emerging nation, following after God Bamidbar in the wilderness, also known as the Book of Numbers. I'm going to carry on because I get to share the next buzzword, and the word is spill. Feel free to chat in your responses too. Spill.
Okay, spill. I have two new Haggadot this year. I confess I have a real Yetzihara to buy new Haggadot every year. And as I looked at it, I said, this doesn't look like a real Haggadah yet. Because a real Haggadah, first of all, has matzah crumbs inside, 100%. And somewhere there's some red, there's something spilled on it for sure. It just hasn't been broken in yet. Thank you.
Amazing. Oh man. I was hoping I'd have an extra few seconds to think about it, but you caught me fast. But I saw Michelle wrote in the chat, and Judy as well. Judy, are you an Aunt Judy as well? Because that would be important to know. You're someone's Aunt Judy in the world, I'm sure. And so much sharing about the spilling of wine out of sadness. And I'm thinking about also like the spilling of wine out of abundance, that sometimes the way we spill, whether it's in the formal moments of spilling or even the accidental moments of spilling that Rabbi Brecha referenced, there's a sense that at the Seder, even if we aren't in the best economic position, there's a sense of like the abundance of the Seder night, that sometimes things, something's going to spill, and that's okay, because that's part of what it is to be Bnei Chorin, to be free, is that, okay, a little wine is left over, or a little wine gets spilled on the plate or on the tablecloth. Like, that's okay, because we're a free people, that we don't have to worry about every single drop. And I think that's a beautiful mentality to have on the Seder, and one to, you know, that should inspire us to make sure that everybody can feel that sense of abundance in our community, even those who are not yet able to feel that on a day-to-day, that we can work towards making sure that happens.
Thank you. Following up on what Michelle shared with us, her following her grandfather's minhag. So at our table, when it comes to dropping the 10 drops out of the kos, out of the cup onto our plates, there's a little machloket that happens between some members of our family about whether you should dip your finger in or whether you should use another implement. And those who are Kohanim in our family have a particular hesitancy about dirtying, sullying their fingers, which are usually used for obviously worshiping or blessing the nation. And so there's sort of this inherent desire not to sully hands in the wine. And so some of the men in my family use a fork or a knife rather than their fingertips. Okay, my word is, I just have to know what everybody's minhag is for karpas. You don't have to tell me a minhag, but in addition to the word associated with karpas, I just must know.
Karpas is the moment of the vegan's triumph, when we compel people all around the world to eat vegetables in a ritual. It's a joyous, joyous moment. And growing up, we definitely had celery. Now we've definitely expanded categories, potatoes, and you know, the bowl of various things. We haven't gone to strawberries yet, although I've seen that idea out there. I think I always appreciate munching on parsley, just because that's like a different palate experience than almost every. Now that we have kale, we're sort of used to kind of munching that kind of green. But like munching on parsley, it's to me, that's sort of the ultimate karpas moment. Even though I'm used to the crunch of the celery, the munch of the parsley for me is the ultimate karpas moment.
Karpas. I grew up in a very tight halachic structure to our seder. So we had a very, very small piece of carrot. That was it. Weren't any options. No parsley, no potato. Not potato. That's like, no. A little piece, must be less than a kazayit. My father explained it every year why it has to be. We have expanded beyond that. And one year I was at my daughter in Israel. My oldest grandchildren were then, 7 and 9, 8 and 10, something like that. And they decided to have a crudité. Is that how you pronounce it? Thank you. Whew. Okay, got past that one. So that people wouldn't be so hungry and they'd have something to munch on, which is a different halachic take, which has become more popular lately. But this was the, and I actually taught it to them because I learned it from my Rebbe, Reb Jeff. And here was the best part. I had my grandchildren ask every single person who was coming to the Seder what their favorite Borei Pri HaAdama was. So they compiled a list. They had to go down to the makolet. They bought it. They put together the platters. So for me, karpas at this point has a very positive connotation. I don't actually know with Martin what we eat. What do we eat? Parsley, potato? Parsley and potato. Okay, no. Any Borei Pri HaAdama.
Amazing. I think my earliest childhood memories of karpas was, I guess we didn't eat celery during the year, which seems weird because celery is like a great vegetable. But I remember getting celery. I would eat celery at the Seder, and I think no one told me when you were supposed to swallow. And celery is like one of those vegetables that you can kind of just keep chewing indefinitely. Like there's never a moment where you know that it's that you've finished chewing it. Like it just kind of keeps going and going and going. And I remember even I'm quick to tears. I don't know if anyone knows that about me. You've all probably seen me cry at various classes or dress out or different things. And I remember one year maybe being, I was 4 or 5, being very upset that I didn't know when I was supposed to swallow the celery because I just kept chewing it, and it was so overwhelming. But we've really leaned into the expansive, to the very expand, leaned in, there you go, lean to the left on the expansive karpas. And I think it's allowed for our very elongated magid to feel more comfortable. We leave the karpas out during magid, and people continue to munch and chew on the vegetables through into various, you know, dips that Mayan prepares through the duration of Magid, and allows us to have a more enjoyable time talking about the text and the Pesach story as people really dig in. So that's our minhag for karpas. But celery and parsley are for sure like the traditional ikar for us as well. My word, and this is the last word of the lightning round, is Manischewitz. Manischewitz.
Manischewitz. This is rough. Growing up in South Africa, maybe for many of you, there was only Manischewitz. That was it. That was the wine. And it is totally the wine that I associate with Pesach Seder and Kiddush. But I will just quickly share that apparently, if you're on Instagram, there is a thing for artists to use Manischewitz bottles and all sorts of artistic works, not necessarily Jewish artists. It's like a thing that there's thousands and thousands of renditions of different artistic things with a Manischewitz bottle in the center. And my mother-in-law, a blessed memory, indeed acquired one of these and had a lamp, the base of which was a Manischewitz bottle and the top was a lampshade.
I'm not going to share my screen, but rather just hold this up. If you can see it. That's Manischewitz marble cake mix. My primary association with Manischewitz is not matzah or wine, but it's cake mix. There was a particular piece of counter in our kitchen where the cake mixes were made on, you know, the days leading up to Pesach and Chol HaMoed Pesach. And I particularly remember also apropos of Rav Ezra's childhood uncertainty, like when is it marble cake mixed up enough, the two different components in order to like officially acquire the name marble and then be able to go into the oven. And that was my main childhood baking was Pesach cakes from the cake mix.
So I have the opposite of that, Rav Steven, because I grew up in a household where we only ate hand shmura matzah the whole Pesach, the whole Pesach. So we had no idea what cake mixes were. We had no idea about any of that. But what Manischewitz does bring up is, these are the words that came up for me, ruby red, heavy, sweet, home. And we had something called a karfinka. I don't know what that is in Yiddish, but it was this really beautiful crystal decanter. And when you poured the Manischewitz wine in, it looked very beautiful. And we were never allowed to bring bottles to the table. We could only bring the karfinkas to the table. And I will finish by saying that I'm very grateful that today we have low alcohol wine, because Manischewitz does not. I can spell decanter. I think with a K. I don't know. Maybe it's a made up word. I have no idea. But I'm very glad that today I don't have to drink Manischewitz wine, because I drink the whole cup, all four. So I go with the low alcohol wine, and I'm very, very grateful that there are new kinds of wine. But my husband, that is still his preference. And everybody should do what they love at the Seder. That's my last line for everyone.
All right. Have a wonderful night, everyone. The hour is late. This was so beautiful and special. We're so glad for everyone who wrote into the chat, and for people who were thinking all kinds of beautiful things that I'm imagining because you didn't get a chance to write into the chat. And for everyone who's busy folding laundry or cooking for Pesach or, you know, wiping down a stovetop, we're so glad you joined us this evening. And wishing you all a Chag Sameach V'Kasher, a joyful and kosher Pesach. It was a pleasure to spend the evening together. Folks can feel free to unmute themselves to wish each other a good night. This is a larger group. As we, I'll put up this little music on in the background. All right, have a great night.
Thanks, Sameach. Happy Friday.
Thanks, Sameach. Love
to
all.
Hakash Shavu Sameach, everyone.
Hakash Shavu
Sameach. Hakash Shavu Sameach.
Hakash Sameach.
Thank you. This is
lovely. Good night, everybody.
Good night to all the Aunt Judys.
Bye.
Good night, Ram.
There was an Auntie Judy, too. Auntie Judy.
Tanta Judy.
Tanta Judy, you got it.
Good night, everyone. Love you too.